Good morning, everyone. My name is Lindsay, and today I have the pleasure of introducing Professor Takis Metaxas. Professor Metaxas is a professor of computer science and the founding director of the Media Arts and Sciences program at Wellesley College. His current research projects are in computational social science. In particular, he is interested in studying the power of crowdsourcing in social networks, especially related to the prediction of political events. He's also interested in developing tools that support the privacy of users while estimating the trustworthiness of the information the user receives. Professor Metaxas studied mathematics at the University of Athens and computer science at Brown. He has a PhD in computer science from Dartmouth and has been a visiting scientist at MIT, the Sydney University in Australia, and at Harvard. In the past, Professor Metaxas was a member of the Computing Research Association's Board of Directors, and he was also the Chief Technology Officer of a biotech company, which he led to gain FDA approval for computerized tests that measure the symptoms of mental disorders. He is a member of numerous professional associations and conference program committees. As a former student and research assistant, I am not surprised that Professor Metaxas has received an Albright Award for Teaching Excellence, as well as two Hoffman Fellowships to support his research. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Professor Metaxas.
It's a great pleasure to be here. It's a great pleasure to be introduced by my co-author. Some of the work you will see today actually was done with the help of Lindsay. And Albright is an institute that I care deeply, and I enjoy every time I get the chance to give a talk. So I understand that you are close to the last phase of your work. You're kind of working now on your projects. You try to get information about how to analyze subjects you are debating with each other. So it is a very challenging and a very exciting time in your experience in the Albright Institute. So I think having this talk at this point might actually help you think a little more clearly, let's say, about how you find information and what you should include in your arguments when you're presenting them. So, in particular, I will be talking about how to understand rumor propagation in the web and in social media that we all use. And, you know, to make it obvious that I care a lot about social media, you can probably recognize my Twitter handle there. I have to warn you that the talk will start with the bad news and will end up with the good news. So if you find yourself halfway in the talk to say things like, think something like, oh my God, we're doomed. No, there is hope. And the hope, the name of the hope is the crowd. And I'll explain what I mean. So I got interested in the issue of information on the internet quite some time ago. With another Wellesley student, we produced this paper. Of course, it's true, I saw it on the internet. It's a variation of something my father used to say whenever he wanted to explain to you that something is true. You know, of course it's true, I saw it on the newspaper. Things have changed since, and news appear on the web much earlier than they appear in newspapers. But that is a paper published in 2002. What I found, however, was a little disturbing. And this research was done in several other schools as well. It's kind of asking college students to answer a bunch of questions. And what we found was that people were finding probably the computer at that time, at least, a little challenging. So the process of finding an answer, kind of figuring out what the right keywords to put in a search engine, was much more important than actually analyzing what they were getting. It used to be the case in the past that in order to find an answer to your questions, you would need to spend long hours in a library somewhere, in dark and not well-lit places, trying to find the source that you really needed. And so maybe we were confusing a little bit the effort to find information with the value of the information itself. The truth was that librarians were doing a very good job in actually figuring out what should be in the library. Now this has changed, and we did not immediately make the change that now to find information is easy and it's fast. What's important actually is to make sense of what you read. So I'll show you some of the results of another survey I did years later when I was trying to figure out what type of questions people were looking up on the internet and which ones they were actually asking friends, relatives, newspapers, professors. So in this later survey, and I have given this survey for a number of years. The results include not only students but also faculty at universities around the world, and even medical students in various parts. So I was asking a bunch of questions. You wonder whether you could get the flu by handling money. And the question is, that I'm asking for each one of these potential research questions is, where would you look for an answer? You would like to know something factual, like who invented the television, something that has to do with morality. You would like to decide whether having an abortion should be considered moral. Something that has some kind of prediction towards the future, or using your current knowledge to predict the future. You'd like to figure out whether technology could potentially help reduce poverty in Africa, and something that has to do with political decisions, whether a particular candidate was, good enough. And when I gave these questions to people, I asked them to choose one of these possible, actually any of these possible answers as their answers. They can check multiple places. So would you say that you already know your answer? Would you not say that you would ask a family member for the answer, some religious authority, a professor, someone else, a librarian, a newspaper, an advertisement, the internet? Not in this particular order, as you will see, but it's not important. So I tried to cover all possible sources. Did I miss any? It seems like, you could probably take it one of those and make it more specific, but pretty much I thought that it was. So the first thing that I try to notice is how people decide where to look for an answer. If you had to choose between a number of different potential sources to check for an answer, how would you decide who or what to ask? That's the interactive part that Mike was saying yesterday.
You might start with the easiest thing. You might, I don't know whether that would be Google or whether that would be asking someone, or, you might start with the least complicated.
The least complicated, the easiest, the most convenient, yeah.
Yeah.
Heather? Yeah.
The one with the most authority on the subject that you're thinking about?
Authority. So somebody with authority might know the right answer. The assumption we're making here is that somebody with authority somehow has gained this authority, so probably has the knowledge for that. Anything else?
Thanks. I think it's really interesting, specifically with moral questions or questions around abortion, to think about the taboo that's inherent in that. So talking to a person, even someone you might ask for other moral advice, you might not, because of a taboo or embarrassment or whatever.
So thinking about whether the answer you will get from this person, it's not a matter of convenience and not a matter of knowledge, but whether you could even trust that, because some of them you would not. I love your answers, because in fact, this is what I was finding and you gave them right away. Do they know what they're talking about? Can I trust what they will tell me? And is it convenient? Years ago, when I was asking the same kind of questions, people's mind was not coming to convenience right away. But now we are in a situation in which, you know, convenience is God, and if we can do it quickly, we can do that. Yeah. So what did I find? I will show you one particular result, but it is, you know, no matter what was the different group I asked, I got the same kind of answer. So in the question about how to, whether you can get the flu by handling money, the winner was the internet. That's the big bar there. Religious authorities did not figure into that, as you can imagine. Well, it wasn't always like that. And, you know, sometimes they will ask your family. Who was the inventor of the television? This is a fact that people felt much more comfortable that they will look primarily on the internet. All right, and everything else was coming much less pronounced there. About morality of abortion was one case in which people preferred more than anybody else a friend or family member. You know, here is the trust that Chloe was saying. We will look at somebody who might tell us something we can trust. However, notice that the internet is very close. A book is second, and the internet is third, but pretty close, all these of. Whether technology can reduce poverty, the internet again is a winner there, but books and authorities like professors who might know the answer come close to that. And the quality of electoral candidates, the internet again was the primary winner, though family members also come and newspapers also come. So if there is one lesson to draw from all of this, which was the resource that we almost always search first? That's the internet, whatever that means. We will see what it means. What was the one resource we will never consult? Advertisement. Duh, you know, would you want to be... Right. You wonder why we have ads if nobody pays attention to them, huh? And what is, you know, not as bad as the ad, but what is another category that we also don't consult that much, almost on anything? Ah, you saw the religious authorities, though there was the morality in which we consulted them. Above them is a random person. We wouldn't trust a random person, right? Or would we? Well, we'll see. So let's keep this in mind. It seems like the internet is the winner above all, advertisement is the loser, and a random person is close to the loser. And from there on, we kind of specifically ask people that they might be better, in better position, gives an answers. I'll show you this advertisement, which you might have seen, to see whether you can feel any kind of excitement or disappointment or, you know, any kind of emotions seeing this advertisement. That was, it's a little old, it was in the previous, in the 2008 elections. Do we still feel that we cannot be influenced by advertisement? You know, it's irrelevant whether you like it or not, whether you believe it or not, whether you think it was outrageous or accurate. It's impossible not to feel some kind of emotional reaction to that. The advertisement was actually a adjustment over on top of another advertisement that was played in 1984. It was the advertisement that introduced Macintosh, and the girl that was running, throwing the sphere there was, you know, the Macintosh who was hitting the Big Brother, which at that time was, no, IBM. Microsoft was not the Big Brother back then. Things kind of change over time. So you couldn't be surprised if people were influenced by that, how they decide how to vote or who to get angry with or who to support more. But I can tell you that this was not an advertisement that came from the camp of Barack Obama. It was a guy who, with a very small budget, took a copy of the old advertisement and adjusted it so that it would play it on the internet, and whoever got it, got it. And, you know, then if you are in the in the campaign of Barack Obama, you have a lot of explaining to do and try to say, no, we do not know this person. And people say, yeah, right, you know, we know that you do that. People love, some people love conspiracy theories. I have to be careful with my language because usually we talk in generic terms. And what we mean is that I know a specific example that this is not true, but usually we say, oh, that's in general not true. So anyway, advertisement has a lot of power, and what we are exposed to affects us a lot. You will be a different person by the time I finish this talk. You are already a different person than when I started talking, and it's not because I have any particular influence on what I'm saying to you. It is because any piece of information we get affects us. Any piece of information we get affects us. And we better be aware that this is happening to us instead of thinking that we just have discovered the truth and this is how the world was always. So it helps a little bit if we start thinking how we view the world, each one of us, you, me, everybody, you know, we usually think ourselves at the center of the world, and we are surrounded by a lot of resources like friends, family, teachers, advisors, sources, acquaintances, ads, and that internet, which, by the way, we should be calling it the web. The internet are really the wires that connect these devices, and the web is what contains the information. So, from now on, I will try to call it the web. But if I were to ask in the original question, you know, do you consult the web? People would say, huh, you know, I get on the internet, right? So I have drawn everything as if are equidistant, but this is not really the case. Some things are closer to us. So our friends and family are closer to us in, you know, influencing our opinion, and teachers and other colleagues, trusted colleagues, are a little further out. Other advisors, a little further out. The news, the books. Acquaintances are very far, and the ads are even further away. So I've kind of drawn them in a spiral way, and the closer are the ones that we kind of care more. And I didn't put the web yet. The web, it covers all of us. It's not only us that were influenced by the web, but everybody else is influenced by the web, by everything we need. We are a species who thinks. We're a species who makes decisions based on prior information, on memory and stuff. And so we take everything in and we try to make decisions, as you will be making very soon, about what to include in your report and what not to include, what to give value and what not to give value. Everybody else around us also is influenced by this internet. By this web. So in computer science, we try to make sense of these kind of relationships because they are relationships that we have. And we use this term called a network. By now, you are familiar with the term network because you have seen the Social Network movie and it has become part of our dictionary. A few years ago, you wouldn't necessarily expect somebody knew what it was, a network. So a network has nodes and arcs. Nodes are the entities, us, concepts, other entities in the world, and arcs are trust relationships that we have with these kind of entities. If I were to give you, you know, 10 minutes and a piece of paper and a pencil, you could design, you could draw your own personal network. You know, you would start putting yourself, let's say, in the center of the page and then start thinking, you know, where is dad, where is mom, where is, you know, uncle, where is that professor, where is that friend, that partner, anybody else that you would know. It's a huge one, but we manage to keep everything in our mind and we keep updating it according to, you know, new information that we get. So if we find out that that partner that we were trusted turns out to be a complete, you know, dingo, then we would change the distance and we would, you know, put it somewhere else. So this is the trust network that we have. We carry in our minds and we live daily. It has inconsistencies for each one of us. You know, we might find weird why we trust this person, but not every one of our decisions is logical. Don't forget that, no matter who you are. So this network also can be challenged by any one of these entities, and the devastation we might feel whenever these networks challenge goes in this direction. You know, if we learn that this bottle of pills will really not make us, you know, taller and thinner, it's okay. We kind of expected that we shouldn't trust this advertisement that much. But if somebody very close to us, you know, kind of give us something that we do not expect, then our devastation goes way up. So we are also challenged in this network through something that we call usually propaganda. This is a term that you have heard, and it has to do with the information that we're getting. Have you tried to ever define what is propaganda? It's kind of the concept we'll know. You want to give it a try to tell me what you think is propaganda? Yeah.
Maybe information or opinions that are designed to make us think a certain way.
Information or opinion that make are designed to make us think in a certain way. Yeah, that's quite accurate, I think. I have given a similar definition here. It is an attempt to modify your behavior and influence your actions in ways beneficial to propagandists. And the reason I have put it that way and I have highlighted these words is for another reason that you will see very soon. So propaganda is trying to essentially change our view of the world, change our trust networks in such a way that our future actions will be influenced by that. We all see it whenever we have political elections, and we can imagine that, you know, advertisement in political elections are trying to change our view of the world or a candidate and thus vote in certain way. But actually it works everywhere. The biggest propagandist out there is the industry of advertisement. That's how they make the living. They try to change your opinion about what to buy, how to live your life, so that actually they will get some benefit, usually some financial benefit or other benefits. You know, ideological propaganda can also be seen these ways, that you would live your life in ways that they think is appropriate. Propaganda goes way back. As a matter of fact, the first time the term propaganda was mentioned was in a decree by a pope whose name I forget in the 17-somethings about the propagation of true faith at that time. But it became much more critical in the two wars. By the end of the First War, it had become such a fancy tool to use. You wanted really to bend your enemy's will to fight, or with whom your enemy should sign, with whom your third parties should line up. There was a big effort in the United States to bring United States on the side of the Nazi Germany instead of the side of the Allies, and there were some major personalities who were trying to do that. It did not happen. There was a group in New York City that studied the way that propaganda was conducted at that time, and they came up with a set of propagandistic techniques. It says, you know, here is how propagandists are doing their job. And by the way, being able to recognize the propagandistic techniques, you're able essentially to defend against them. So if you're aware that somebody's using this technique, is extremely helpful in, you know, figuring out how to address it. Putting a name next to a concept is very powerful. Remember that. Whenever you write your report, whenever there is something you try to explain, the best way is to actually figure out what is a good definition for this that you're trying to explain and name it. And suddenly you get great power on your ability to explain things. The same thing happens in mathematics, in science. You know, whenever you need a concept that you need really to explain and analyze, you give it a name. So the more known propagandistic techniques, number one, are the word games. You start using a negative or a positive word for a concept or a person, and as you use it, the underlying assumption is that this concept or person has this characteristic. So if I keep talking in positive terms about the weather in California all the time, well, it's probably good. But you know, everybody will start feeling the weather in California is good, you know, live in California and forget that there are earthquakes that can be damaging. And for people, this is even more pronounced. The other is the so-called plain fog technique. The propagandist is trying to explain that people like us, we have something in common, and people like us just think this way. You know, Wellesley students are like that. Wellesley students all do that. The 50 things that Wellesley students will do, you know, if you don't do it, you're really a loser. You really want to do them. So this is a very subtle one, but makes you feel that you're part of that group. Another that you see very often is bandwagon, where there is something happening, like the new fashion, and you better jump on this bandwagon, otherwise you would be left behind. So suddenly everybody walks around with Uniqlo jackets these days. It seems like, you know, why on earth? I don't know, but if you don't have one, you better run. They're on sale right now. The next one is the testimonial. That's something the advertisers use a lot. So they put in front of the TV somebody who's dressed up as a doctor, and this person, you know, recommends that you take one of these every day and you get more handsome, more tall, more sexy, more whatever. That's all it takes to believe it. I'm generalizing intentionally now because, you know, you know that this is not true for everybody, but you recognize people that actually fall for that, no? The one thing that we always think about propaganda is the term card stalking. When you're using, you know, you stack your cards, you're just using bad logic. And this is the propaganda we are always able to recognize a little better because we can use logic on demand and figure out if something is true or false. But that's not the only way. Propaganda is based on our emotions, not on logic. And so card stalking works well when you get so excited about something that logic becomes secondary, whether this is true or false. And finally, the most dangerous is the technique of transfer. When you have somebody at a higher office, maybe somebody who is well respected, let's say a cleric, some representative of a religious, organization, who will tell you something that they should not be experts on, like who you should vote for or, you know, what you should eat or stuff like that. So these are the kind of propagandistic techniques. And the reason I am showing them to you now is because each one of them has as an effect to change our trust network, the one I was saying that we have in mind. For example, you know, here is our trust network. And according to the definition of bandwagon technique, the idea of behind the bandwagon is that the propagandist attempts to convince us that all members of a group to which we belong are accepting that program and they should follow the crowd. You know, the way that you see it, for example, is that you meet somebody, I name him there, Joe the Plumber, who happens to be part of the cool club and start talking about the cool club. And if you're not part of the cool club, you don't feel good. So suddenly you need to go to that club. That's one way. You know, it's a suggestion. And just because this has a collection of people claiming that this is good, you feel that it must be good. Another technique that, as I said, the advertisers use a lot is the testimonial technique, when a respected person is given an idea, tells you that an idea or a program or a product is good or bad. So, you know, your famous actress will tell you that this is the best diet ever. You know, what does she know about diet, you know? But you know how successful these advertisements are. They're in every week, there are dozens in every magazine. So if there are so many good dieting plants out there, does it mean something about each one of them, how good they are? I mean, if there was a good one, we wouldn't need a second, right? All right, just to think. So the web is also a network, and here is where our trust network with the web as we communicate is. You recognize the picture there. Some of you are featured in this picture. This is a web page. Each web page is a node in the web. And, okay, what are the links? The links are the hyperlinks that we use whenever we want to link one page to another. Pretty much whenever you create a link, you are creating a pointer to something else. And all of these together taken creates the web, which is a huge, huge, huge network. And it's so huge that we cannot even capture all of it at any moment. All the search engines together can only capture maybe 15% of the whole internet there. And what is visible from that is even less. So going back to our trust network, now that we have in mind the web as part of our network, we also have the web as part of our network. And the question is, how exactly are we connected with that network? Well, we're connected through the social media and the search engines. So we use Facebook. Any of you would be strong enough to admit that you don't do Facebook? Okay, you don't count. It's one of the things that it keeps us intact, and we get a lot of information through Facebook. I use a lot of Twitter, but I also, every time I need to find an answer, I go and I search engines like Google and Bing. So this is how our trust network greatly is increasing, and we access it through the search engines, and many of us, so we counted for you too, through social networks. All right, so in fact, through social networks, you find information you didn't expect to find. Maria in the morning, you know, told us about the news that happened today, but something that you wouldn't necessarily find is something that I was informed through my network the other day, that lots of Greek Orthodox mourners served biscuits sprinkled with cocaine. And for those of you that this seems like weird, I'll tell you what the cookies look like. They have powdered sugar on top of them. So you can imagine somebody sprinkling. The story goes that there was some baker who was involved into drugs and accidentally sprinkled, or he was trying to hide it from the police, whatever. And, you know, that's what happened. So these are the kind of things, oh my God, really, I did not know about that. And it has several shares and eventually got to me. Of course, I paid attention because I happen to be Greek. And so, you know, that attracted my attention. You wonder, is that true? At this point, it can be anybody's guesses, right? Whether this is true or false. You need a little bit of work to figure it out. And the question is, do you care? Sometimes you don't care. There are several little lies that we, you know, hear every day, and it doesn't matter. Some other cases it might matter. You know, some people might think that this ridicules Greeks, so that is darn important. Others say, yeah, it's just a joke. Who cares, you know? So the reason that we're not absolutely sure is because I read this on the web. I did not read it on a book or did not hear it from a trusted resource. And in fact, anybody can be an author on the web. Here we have a story in which the boy is trying to, you know, read this important news, and his father says, you cannot believe that, that's on the internet. And the boy says, what you're talking about? This is a very important news site. And it turns out that somewhere else another little boy is actually writing that important site. So the fact that anybody can be an author has changed a little bit our understanding. So some years ago, I started kind of looking for this kind of misinformation. And in fact, if you start looking for misinformation, you will find it. For example, I was looking more information about human growth hormones because I had heard that indeed it can make me taller, thinner, sexier, richer, you name it. And what I found at that time was that, it can do all of these things. $39.95, you're all set. That's all, you know? None of the results there seem to be from any kind of medical authority. And I was wondering, why is that the case? Why Google is giving me this kind of news? I was looking at other controversial issues, you know, whether ADHD is really a real disorder or not. And the results I got at that time was, oh, no, it is a conspiracy. Psychiatrists are doing that to drug all our kids, and that's all it is. There is no basis to that. These are just some of the examples that got me really interested in looking into that. And I've spent several years kind of looking at these questions and also trying to figure out how do you find the truth, if there is such a thing. Being a scientist, I thought for a long time that finding the difference between true and false is doable. It just requires a lot of effort, but it is doable. I'll show you why I changed my opinion in later in this talk. So you wonder why on earth there is this kind of misinformation and comes up in the search engines. You will not find this particular fake results at this order, of course, now, but you will find others. And the answer to why is simple. If it's not on Google, it doesn't exist, as people say. You know, if an answer to what the old man says, I spend my entire life searching for meaning. The meaning of life is what we all search. And the kid says, well, if it's not on Google, you won't find it. You know, we tend to believe that if you don't end up high in the ranking of the search engines, you may well not exist. If you cannot find something, you probably not. So how this kind of influence in the search engine's search result happens, it happens through what we call web spam. And what is web spam? Here is a definition that you might find familiar because of the discussion we have. Web spam is the attempt to modify the web, the structure and the contents of the web, and thus influence the search engine's results in ways beneficial to web spammers. So a web spammer is targeting you, but is using the search engine as the intermediary, because we trust the search engine. If they can compromise the search engine's results, then they can make us believe what they want. In this case, is to sell their product or to promote their own ideas. So it was at that time when I started realizing, God, why is it such a similarity between propaganda and spam? And the answer is, in both cases, you have a network. One is the trust network in your mind, the other is the network on the web. And in both cases, you could use technology or information to essentially alter our perception. So you're sitting in the corner and the web is out there and you have a search engine and you want to find an answer to something. So you have a query, you would like to know what about that. Then you send a query to the search engine, you go to the box and you type a few words and your answer comes back. Your answer comes back, but it comes in an order. It will tell you that it found, you know, a gazillion and a half of results, but here are the first 10. And by the way, the first two above those first 10 would be advertisement, if you are careful enough to notice it. So ranking is important. When a search engine ranks the results, kind of tell us what is the most important for you to see. And because we will never be influenced by things that we never saw, the things that we see are important. So it's important what comes up there. In fact, this is such an important part of a search engine. Essentially, the quality of the search engine is based on how it ranks things. So the importance is such that the whole evolution of the search engines could be seen as attempts by the search engines to improve the ranking of results, and so make it easier for you to actually find what you want. So I'll give you very briefly, very quickly, because it's not important that we go through that now, how the search engines have evolved. The first generation search engines were based just on counting words. And the idea is that more words, relevant words appear in document, the more relevant the document it is. It's very simple, naive, but it works easily. So we usually count the words here, all the works of Shakespeare, and we count the words that Anthony and Brutus and Caesar appear, and we better normalize it based on, you know, the length of the document. You know, a long document will have more reference than others. So after we normalize, then we look for a query, let's say we try to see where in the Shakespeare documents the term "in the mercy of Caesar" exists. So we look at where is mercy, you look where is Caesar, then you kind of sum up the different results there, and you find out that in Anthony and Cleopatra the result would be 2.8, so that's probably the most relevant book related to that. And most of the time that works very well. So that's what you would find. But if you were a spammer, let's say you are somebody who has produced a new book that talks about Shakespeare or imitates Shakespeare, and you would like your book to come higher up, how would you spam it? How would you persuade the search engine that your book, if you count it, is going to be more relevant than Anthony and Cleopatra? It comes from your right.
Sorry, Caitlin. You could just use a lot of those words, Caesar and Mercy.
Yeah, use a lot of words. So, you know, start putting a lot of words here. You know, it's a search for Jennifer Aniston, and here a lot of words that have these, and it will make this come on top of anything that it is really about Jennifer Aniston. This is about everything. All right? And search engines realized that, got really pissed off. And in fact, when BMW started using this technique in order to promote its website, BMW, for God's sake, Google decided that for 6 months, BMW was to be disappearing from the search results of Google. And people at BMW might got very upset about that, but there was a court decision early on deciding that the search engines own the data they have collected, no matter if they're yours or not, and thus they can do that. So the search engines then came up with a better idea. They said, okay, it's not enough that you have the right words, it's how well you are connected. So if you have more more pages pointing to you, you are more important. So it created what we call a popularity vote. The more popular you are, the more important you are, all right? And so first you look at similarity, and then when you rank on popularity. And then in this case, the BB would be the most relevant result because it has three pointers pointing to it and the others have less. But now, if you're a spammer and you know that that's what the search engines are doing, how do you try to fool them again?
You could put your link in lots of places.
You could put your link in a lot of places. So, in fact, you would create your own link farms. You would create a bunch of sites that you own, and therefore you can put your links to each one of those, and then you would link them together. This is, by the way, a site that's selling the human growth protein, and you can see that they have gone into a bit of effort to make people realize that, oh my God, we are so popular. All right? And then the great idea came, the idea of PageRank. And PageRank says it's not enough to be popular. You have to be popular by the right kind of people. And who are the right people to be popular? Those who are already important. So you have to be important in order to be popular. So every page has a rank, and then your rank is being split among those that you are pointing to, and you're receiving a portion of the rank that they're giving to you. It's like a currency, and you exchange the currency. It looks like an infinite loop, but the beauty is that actually the calculation can stop at some point and eventually calculate. The idea comes from academic citations. How do you know that Professor X is an important professor? Well, when other important professors are citing this professor. So that gives you an extra authority when you have this kind of citations. This is important because it gives a kind of numeric evaluation of how we conceptually think of the world of trust. So that's what Google first thought about, and it became very popular, very powerful. Every search engine is doing it these days. And how do you spam it? If you are a spammer, are you completely out of luck now? Because you cannot really do that? It used to believe that, yeah, that's the case. PageRank is darn good and cannot kill it. I thought of that at some point, and then I thought of a way that I could fool Google gee, and then started looking, I realized, no, many have done that before me. People created what I call neutral admiration societies. You become an expert in your own little world. Let's say you are selling shoes, and somebody else is selling human growth hormone, and somebody else is a religious organization in a remote place, and somebody else is, you know, kind of a school who's selling raffle tickets. Since you are, you know, your own little entity, authority in the little world, if you agree with each other to link to each other, they're completely relevant, you know, in what they do. But if you agree to link, everybody wins. See how it works? So it's getting into a party and you hear people talking about others with great admiration, and suddenly all of these people become great, very important. So here I have a little ad of one of these little mutual admiration societies who very explicitly say, in order to come into our group, you have to do the following thing. First, you have to have page rank of 5. We don't get any with smaller page rank. And then you make a link to us. To each one of us. And when you finish, we will put a link to you, and everybody eventually gets up with page rank 6. And then we continue this kind of trick and we become very important. In fact, there was a whole industry that was built on that. Very powerful, very expensive, creating this kind of links. So here is an example, I guess, in which collaboration works in bad ways, but it does work. As a matter of fact, collaboration works most of the time, almost all the time. But here is a case in which was not used in a very kind of trusted way. But that was, you know, this kind of page rank was not the only thing that the search engines were doing. We're doing other things. For example, they were also using anchor text. Anchor text is when you're using some kind of a script to explain what the link is about. So here are different kind of pages pointing to www.wellesley.edu. One is making the reference from the anchor text Women's College, others from near the liberal arts, etc., etc. So you learn a lot about what the website is by what people use in order to point to it. So it is like a short explanation of what the final page is. So it used to be that people would just say, right on the web, you can click here to go somewhere else, and they would, you know, put as anchor text. But here is really not having much information. When people started putting much more descriptive text in this anchor, then this became a very powerful technique. And the spammers could spam that as well. In fact, it started with a big joke in which a bunch of people associated the term miserable failure with the website of George W. Bush. It became a funny joke. And after a while, those who disliked that joke started creating their own links with, you know, you would put miserable failure and you would put the link to whoever you wanted. If a lot of us do that, in fact, the first success for George W. Bush, it included only 29 pages. So 29 people were enough to essentially create this kind of big movement. And so those who disagreed, you know, put in number 2 Jimmy Carter, then Michael Moore, then Hillary Clinton. And as soon as Obama came into office, he became the miserable failure. This has been used quite a bit as a joke, but also for political discussions in lots of political campaigns, people try to create this kind of anchor text to damage somebody's reputation. You can think of it as kind of word game, or actually it's not word game, is card stalking, in which you use bad logic at what you do. So the way that search engines are ordering the results is influenced by what the spammers are doing, and it has some very close connections to how the spammers and the propagandists are doing their job. And it's not that the search engines are not trying. The search engines keep trying to improve. In fact, a few years ago, Google told us that it has 200 different signals. It's not just PageRank. They try any way they can to essentially defend, yet around the same time that this article appeared, There was in the New York Times a very big story about a big fooling of the search engine. Somebody who is selling fake designer glasses is able to sell more and more because people get these fake glasses, get really upset, go on the internet, and they say, this is a bastard. But they point to the bastard. So he comes right up. And if you're going for cheap designer glasses, you're going to find him again and again and again. So in Greek, I say that here is a Greek proverb that fame and infamy are both advertisement. In Greek, it's more interesting because the word fame appears in both fame, infamy, and advertisement. The affimicy is that. So it is a tough game. It's never ending. There have been some progress, and I can tell you later on. I want to switch now gears and go a little bit into the social networks and misinformation through social networks. This is somewhere I got interested when, again, during elections, I had noticed that back in 2010 in the Massachusetts special elections, it seemed that the searches for Scott Brown, who was one of the candidates at that time, had skyrocketed just before the time of the elections. Scott Brown was relatively unknown at that time, and Martha Coakley was much more known. And so it seems a logical thing that people would search for that there. But when I went to the web to see what people were searching for, I found that in the third place of the search results inside Google, I had the results from Facebook and Twitter and other blogs. Google and the other search engines had made the decision that the results from the social web would come in position number three. And so people were informed about their candidates based on what people were talking about in the social network. So it turns out that the ones about Martha Coakley were much kind of insulting, but not as much for Scott Brown. And so this was happening on Twitter. And show of hands, how many of you have a Twitter account? All right, so you're about half. So for those that you already know, probably it's just a review, but those you do not know, a tweet message is just a short message, just 140 characters. So you have to be very stingy with your words when you're sending a message like that. It's like an SMS, but you can use a URL, you can kind of point to another page to expand on your message. So the message that you send is called a tweet. Now, others have the ability of retweeting, which is an important feature. Retweeting means that I copy, actually I can do it with a click of a button, I click a button and your message that came to me goes to my followers. So you get more exposure of your message if I retweet your message. And the question that at that time I was asking is, why do people retweet? It seems that they retweet a lot. There is also a reply in which you engage in some kind of dialogue with the others, and there is a direct message in which you try to talk to them in person if you follow each other. But the important is short messages and the ability to retweet, that is to verbatim say something that somebody else told you. So when we look at the results, we found out that about 41% were retweets, so a lot of retweets. We look at the relevant keywords, so why people were using so much retweeting. And we also found a weird thing. 32%, one out of three, were repeats. What is a repeat? Repeat is when I send a message, and then I send it again, and then I send it again, and then I send it again. Now, it's the very same people who will get my message. Only those who pay attention to what I say. So it can become very annoying very quickly if I tell you the very same thing time and again, right? So it was surprising why people keep repeating all of these things. So we did a little analysis for each one of those. First, why people retweet. Well, the assumption we made was that you retweet something because it's verbatim if you agree with that. And in fact, if you were a Democrat, you were very, very likely to retweet something that the Democrat said. If you were a Republican, very, very likely that you will repeat something that the Republican said. I mean, we have elections. This is an important time. You do not waste your words for things that, you know, your enemies would like. So retweet reveal, in fact, communities. We actually, when we tried to draw the network of retweets, we found something like that. The density and the separation of the two groups that you see comes naturally. This is drawn with something we call a force-directed drawing. So the more often you retweet somebody else, the closer you become to this other account. So you see two groups there, and so you can see that the one we drew as blue is the Democrat group was smaller. It is dense, but the Republican was much larger. And the size means how often did you do. There were some accounts here who were doing a lot of tweeting, so some kind of zealots who were trying to do a lot of it. So in fact, if you wonder whether somebody votes Democratic or Republican, all you have to do is kind of see where do they appear in a graph like that. And so voting is not necessarily secret anymore. With the repeating was the weird thing. Why people repeat continuously all of these, the same messages? And it dawned on us, gee, it had to do with the way that Google was working these days. Google was putting in third place the results that came from Twitter. So if you want people to see your message, you keep repeating your message so that eventually we'll go into Google. So we call this a Twitter-enabled Google bomb. Google bomb is when you try to push your results up. This is a Twitter-enabled Google bomb. But that was not the only foul play we found. By the way, in case you wonder, Google has changed, and the other search engines a month or two after we published our results has changed that, and now you cannot find the social media results there. So the other thing that we found was what we call a Twitter bomb. A small number of accounts repeating, sending replies to others, informing them of something that was a lie. That supposedly Martha Coakley was had said that Catholics should not become doctors. All right? And that was easy to detect, and now Twitter can detect these kind of accounts. Whenever it sees accounts kind of having identical behavior, it can take it down. So we'd like to believe that we had some effect in the way that Twitter is doing its business as well. Where it was going to this site. In the beginning, they would not tell us who were behind that. Turns out that it was a group called the American Future Fund, which turns out, we found through the internet, that it was actually part of the attack on Kerry in the 2004 election. So these were people that they had some practice trying to fool us. There was yet another operation, which we call here the prefabricated tweet factory. So in this idea, you target specific people, like people of the press. And what do you do with them? You have your friends send them messages telling to the journalists, be careful, I know you're not doing your right job, I'm watching you, you're not saying the truth, and stuff like that. Now, it's not easy to organize a large number of people to independently do that, so what they did instead is that they came up with lists of tweets. They said, okay, here, go there, grab the tweet, send it. So all you have to do is click once, click twice, and you send it. And where were you sending it? You were sending it to particular stations, you were sending to particular reporters. Here goes to Katie Couric, et cetera, et cetera. So three different techniques that were practiced at that time to influence how people thought. All right, so here is where the bad news end. It seems like we're kind of in a difficult situation because there is so much light out there. How can we even find what is really true? You may have started thinking like, is everything I heard today true? Maybe something I told you was false, right? It would be nice if we would just go somewhere and click and say, okay, here is the right answer. And jokingly here it says, go to criticalthinking.com. It's not exactly like that, but it is not too far from there, as I will tell you. I'll tell you what I mean by that. Understanding how a rumor propagates and eventually get to us is important. So with colleagues like Lindsay and others, we built that site called Twitter Trails. And what do we do there is trying to find an answer on whether something we just ran into is true or false. And this thing that we ran into comes from Twitter. Why I'm so specific to Twitter? It is very easy to collect data in Twitter. Facebook is not going to give you their data, unfortunately. And the search engines have made it very hard to go and collect their data. Twitter is the easiest way of doing that. So let's say you run into, and this is the first case that I really started examining. You run into this story. A plane is spotted on the sea. Maybe you're a reporter, or maybe you're just a citizen. You want to report to others what you just found out. Should you go ahead and retweet it? That is, tell others, my God, a plane is on the sea. Now, this is not a simple question, because this happens 3 weeks after the first Malaysian airliner has disappeared. So everybody's darn nervous. How on earth an airplane disappears, and where is it? So suddenly, 3 weeks later, you find out that another plane has disappeared, or actually another plane is on the sea. So you could help create a panic if you were to retweet it, in particular if you are a journalist, right? So what can you do? Well, we have designed this to help you figure out what you should do. And why it works? It works because of the kindness of strangers, as a book you have read says. The crowd, those random people you would never ask individually, if taken collectively, can actually give you a better answer than any of them. So let me explain what I mean by that. I have kind of tried to formulate a theory, and this theory comes with social theorems. I put the theorem in quotes because it's not like mathematical theorems. Mathematical theorems are those that they're either true or false and you can prove, and it's never the case that, you know, once you proved it correctly, that it is not. But social theorems are those who are more likely true, that is, most of the time turn out to be true, right? So you cannot kill a social theorem by saying, no, I have a counterexample. In order to kill a social theorem, you should have a large number of counterexamples, you know, a big percentage of those, so that you could say that's not really what happens in the majority. So I have developed a theory in, and here I explain three social theorems about what we can do about the problem of misinformation. The first is that retweeting a message indicates an interest, trust, and agreement to this message, which I already told you, you know, I saw it in different context when I was looking for the Massachusetts elections. But in this case, I actually went out and we did a survey and we saw what people think when they retweet. And I'll tell you what people told us. The second theorem is that if you have enough people, if you get enough people's attention and a little bit of time, lies are not propagated much. This is like the most positive thing I have seen in a long, long time. It goes back to what I was taught in high school about Socrates used to say, that nobody is willingly bad. People try to do what is. So is that so, and under what conditions? I'll tell you. And technology can help. This is where Twitter trails plays a role. And the third social theorem is something that it looks almost obvious, that people that have open minds and critical thinking skills are better at figuring out truth than those without. I mean, the whole idea of education is that. So I'll tell you what I found for each one of these different social theorems I did. Now the first one, that retweeting actually means all of these things. Here is the results of a survey, as I said, that we did last summer. And what we found is that by and large, people would retweet something if they find it interesting, almost all the time. But 3 out of 4, and even more, they will retweet something if they found it trustworthy. The message they find, right? Also, if it's informational, you don't want to retweet boring stuff. If it's something that you agree with, duh. You care about your followers, maybe I think that those who pay attention to me, so we have a sense of informing others. Even less something you endorse, you know, these people treat it differently, like agreement. Entertaining is not as important, still important. And emotionally reasoned, they find it less important. So people would really retweet when they find something to be interesting, trustworthy, and they have agreement with. The red line is for reporters. they disagree a little bit. Reporters behave a little differently because of the role, and if you want, I can tell you more about that. The other thing that we found is that the message is more important than the account. If we ask them whether they care whether the account they retweet is credible, yeah, most of the time they care about that, but they don't care if it's somebody they trust as much, they don't care if somebody that they share their opinion, they don't care that much if they're somebody they support, and definitely they don't, or at least that's what they think, they don't care if that person is a celebrity, though we know, Justin Bieber, duh. What I just said is that there is a particular group of people who do that, right? But people will use this kind of generalizations to, you know, it's card stacking, really. All right, so what kind of messages did we look? As I said, the first that I started reviewing was this one. I get this message. It is on March 27, 2014, and I find that somebody has said that there is a picture of an airplane, as you can see there, which is outside of Telde in the Gran Canary, 3 weeks after the Malaysian Airlines. And, you know, I'm thinking exactly this question. Should I retweet it or should I not? It turns out it was, you know, just as our Twitter trails was coming live, and I thought, okay, I'll use Twitter trails. That's what I built it for. Other questions that we have more than 200 questions that we have surveyed so far. Somebody's tweeting, I'm getting on like London tubes changing three times, and now I hear there is a terrorist warning. What is going on? So there is a warning for the London tubes on that day, that is September 1st. Should people go into that? You can imagine, you get this on your Twitter feed, you wonder, do I get into the subway? Here is, looks incredible. Gun killed people. A girl, 9 years old, kills the gun instructor. That looks weird. BBC News, maybe they got it wrong. A 9 years old? You may have heard that somebody said that a 3-year-old killed his mother. I don't know about that. Is that so? You know, these are the kind of questions you could search, or other kind of less kind of serious, like historians unearth eyewitness account of a miracle by Jesus. So somebody found a document that actually somebody reports seeing Jesus performing a miracle, you know. Well, some people, this might be that important. Or that there is a nuclear weapon missing from an army depot. So these are the kind of stories we care more about it, but we also research a lot of other stories. Okay, these are the kind of things you want to find out the answer of. What do you know, do you need to know about a rumor? Well, you would like to know who said it first. Who's the originator? You also would like to know when it became kind of bursty, when it became known. You know, is it something that was told a long time ago and it just became bursty, or it just happening? You would like to know, is the story still spreading or it is actually going down? You would like to know a little bit of the dynamics of how the story propagates. You would like to know, if anything, about who are the propagators, who says so. You would like to know if there are any of these tweets that they say, no, that's not so. If there is any denial to the rumor. And you would like to know who are the main actors in all of this group. All right? So it's a lot of information you would like to know. And ultimately, you would like the system somehow to give you a kind of more complete answer. So here is the case as we saw it with the plane in the Canary Seas. It so happens that at a little before 10, around 10:45 or so, somebody says that finds an image of a plane on the sea. This has gotten almost 600 retweets. It has quite a bit of exposure. So it's a burst right there. This is the person that kind of makes it known. A few minutes later, 112 Canarias confirms that the plane indeed has splashed down. So it's serious. 112 Canarias is like the 911 for the Canary Islands. So that looks darn important. Just, however, a few minutes later, the same one says, the plane is not, it's a tugboat. It just looks like that, all right? And they take it back. And another one says, no. However, there are a lot of other sites, a lot of others who are propagating the false. The blue circles here means that they are usually news organizations.
and the vast majority of them propagate the false information that started. So these reporters had no clue that actually those who were responsible for checking these found out that, no, false alarm, stop it. And it took a while. And, you know, it was reported for a while about that. We found out who was the one who made it so prominent was a sports reporter. So he had his audience, he had some authority. He had not authority on, you know, this kind of news, but he had an audience and made it possible. Looking at how things propagate, we see that it was propagating, but then a negation started propagating. And as soon as the negation comes up, the propagation of the rumor starts subsiding. Now, you could still pick the propagation, but that graph indicates that when people, enough people negate a rumor, that kind of gives pause to the rumor. So if you hear that something might not be true, you're not so quick as to promote the rumor, right? You might either wait and see, or you might actually check for yourself. This is important because this is how the crowd can help you figure out what's true. So we have this interface that will tell you that. You find the retweet graph that will tell you who were kind of the people who were very successful in promoting the news. I will skip and I will show you the system live in a while. You can see who are the major players. These are the ones that have been retweeted by two others. Graphs, networks everywhere, of course. And to make things easier, we kind of come up automatically with a little bit of a summary that says, here's what happens. We are looking for this rumor. This rumor was investigated at this time. And the first one that talked about the rumor was somewhere here. I cannot read so close to it, etc., etc. And you could also determine that the propagation was moderate. And in general, people were dubious about that. So this summary, in particular this line, kind of tells you that rumor doesn't seem to be good. All right, so how do we do all of these things? To make things simpler, we have provided an interface that has these kind of results. So let me see if I can go and show you what our interface looks like. Looks like that, as I said. It has a large number of tweets right now. 166 stories or so are being investigated. We have the rumor here, and you could click and go to each one of those. Ricky Martin was dead. So it tells you that the propagation was moderate, and there was extreme doubt about that. Just looking automatically without, you know, having, who said that there is doubt? The crowd. It does not tell you that it's true or false. It tells you how people treat this information. And this can be part of the answer. Not always, but can be part of the answer. Bruno Mars is a son of Michael Jackson. You know, a lot of them are kind of funny, but there are some not so funny. Mom killed by toddler at Walmart. A 2-year-old, 3-year-old killed his mom. It seems like people think that that's probably right. It's undisputed. It turns out it was. So for any particular case, you know, story, we could do that. So you, when you are using our interface, going through these links, it will tell you what is the, in particular, piece of information that we're saying here. The news organizations say, urgente, ultima hora, you know, things are really bad, plane is spotted, while back here, somebody said, no, false alarm. And the different other interfaces, we have made it so a lot of information is provided right here. What are the URLs that people are linking? Who is the person that sends the information? Even images of the plane as they appear, of that. To make things a little more visually appealing, we have come up with this new design in which we try to have this kind of meter-like design tell you whether something is true or false. So claim girl kills gun instructor seems to be unopposed. Though Betty White is dead, according to the crowd, this is false. According to the crowd, this is false. According to the crowd. So we find, you know, how do we find all of these things? We find it by putting all of these rumors on a plane, and we are measuring amount of propagation versus amount of skepticism. So what is propagation and skepticism? Propagation is how many retweets this particular story gets. All right? So it has kind of low, moderate, high, extreme propagation. And then we have the skepticism. This is, what is the ratio between those tweets that they say, no, the rumor is false, versus those that they say, no, the rumor is true? All right? We actually look at the H index from academic citations. Yeah, I know, I'm done. So for each one of those, what do you observe? It seems that they are coming in two kind of bands. One is coming in this way, and the other is coming in that way, which we find it kind of interesting, right? So it seems that they are separating themselves. Why is that interesting? It is, well, we then go to news organizations, or we do our own research, and we try to find out, is that true or is it false? We paint red those that they are false. We paint blue those that they are true. Do you see something now? Those who tend to be true seem to have high propagation and low skepticism. Those who tend to be false tend to have low propagation and high skepticism. How do you explain that? Well, if you believe that it is true, you will propagate it. If you start believing that this may be false, you might stop, not propagate it, or do your own research and say something about it, that you, what you found. So, see if I can go here. You know, this is the second theorem I'm trying, and the conjecture is that on Twitter, this is important, claims with higher skepticism and lower propagation are more likely to be false, and claims with lower skepticism and higher propagation tend to be true. So here is one case, here is another. Except there is a red dot there. Here is something that has high propagation and low skepticism and turns out to be false. It doesn't work 100%. What is that, you know? What is that rumor? Let's zoom a little bit into that more. See this rumor here? You can actually check it. Yeah, it's a lie that we like to tell. Right? Santa Claus was tracked by NORAD. Very few people said that this is false. Many people produced even pictures showing Santa Claus going around. That's why it's kind of difficult to get for, you know, this is an accepted lie that we say to certain people. We do not believe it, but we do say that. That's kind of interesting. I showed you that. I said that this is important in Twitter because in Facebook this might not be the case. In fact, this was a false story, by the way. And in Facebook it seems like rumors, false rumors, never die. They just go into a lull for a while and then they appear again. In fact, this was a rumor that first appeared in 2011 and then in another time and so on and so forth. Why? My best guess, it has to do with the interface. On Twitter, the claim and the negation come as first-rate citizens there. They have the same exposure, 140 characters. For Twitter, there are these comments that you have to click on sometimes to see what they say, and actually you have to dig into that with much smaller letters to see if anybody says, no, that's not false. Though somebody who sees that has an easy way to click here and share 20 of them in that, you know, new share. So the interface matters, and that makes my adjusted second theorem. Given enough people attention and appropriate interface, lies are not propagated much. So interface matters as well. So as for the third, why do we believe what we believe? It's important to understand how to think that you figure out why you believe what you believe. So applying the scientific method when you're thinking is important. What do I mean? Well, scientific method means you form a hypothesis and then you try to see what is the evidence in favor and against, not just in favor, not just against. And then you look at the results and you try to weigh. Takes time, but it will give you the right answer and understanding yourself. However, we also know things that we learn as children, like the Santa Claus story.
things that we remember incorrectly, things that we have misunderstood, things that we think under the influence of substances. You know, you get drunk, your thinking is not exactly. Voices, things that we think under fear, under anger, under passion, under personal interest. You can find your own. Yesterday, Mike said, well, hormones play a role as well, the way we think. It's not that we're stupid, it's because our brain is not perfect. It's because we're influenced by the limitations in our brain, but also our feeling, our senses, the environment. I go a little fast because I see that I need to stop because I'm sure you want to ask your own questions. We hate randomness, so we try to find an explanation. And if there is no explanation, we come up with conspiracy theories. And to think means that you have to put a lot of energy. The front lobe, which is our thinking power, requires a lot of energy. By the end of this talk, you'll already be tired, even though you're just sitting and doing, you know, theoretically nothing, because you're thinking all the time. We use a lot of energy right here, so we get tired. We try to avoid it as much as possible, and what do? We use heuristics, we use stereotypes. It's our own way of thinking. Why do we know that people of certain kind are criminals or are dangerous? Because these are some of the stereotypes we have used, because it helped us once, we will help us again. Beware of that when you're doing your research. Thank you. And apologies for getting a little over time.
But you're going to be staying for the forum.
I will. So I will, because the next talk is also relevant and very exciting. And if you have any questions right now, I would be delighted, or you want to go directly to the break.
We need the break, is that right?
Then you can come and ask me here.